Today I'm going to make a video that I think could possibly, maybe, hopefully very well be helpful to at least a person, one person. If I've helped one person with this video, then, well, that's disappointing. Today I'm going to explain why it is I start painting in the lightest part of each form. Now that sounds like a strange thing. It sounds like an odd thing to make a video about or even title a video, but I actually think this particular subject could be very helpful to some of you. Now it's going to be most helpful to those of you that try to some degree to paint in the manner you see me paint, where I kind of go over the form, I finish as I go. This could really plug into what you're doing and help you with certain issues. But I'm going to try to talk about the concepts here, the reasons why, and there might be ideas here. I don't want to sell this too big, but there might be ideas here that could be useful to you. Things you might think about, little things you might shift in your workflow or your understanding that could make your color, your form a little bit better. Specifically, I would say that this might help with those of you that deal with washed out colors, muddy colors, or values that get a little bit out of control or drop down too fast as we go around the form. If you sort of think about some of the things I talk about here, practice them or fit them in however you sort of see fit, you might find that you end up with more clean, clearer color, form, values, so on and so forth. One of the most common ways I've seen people paint is that they'll sort of jump all over and they'll mix a color they think they see in an area, and then they'll look for all the other areas they think they see that color and they'll put it down, and then they find the next color and they do the same. That could work, obviously, if you have someone who's very adept at painting, has a lot of experience, is very keen at observing. They could easily do that and it could be successful. But there are issues there, because very often the color you think you see in an area is affected greatly by its surrounding context. So it might look like the same color here and the same color here, but they're actually not, because their local contexts are different. So very often you can get into a lot of trouble if you do that throughout. It's also not very tactile, meaning it's not engaged with the surface. If you think about sculpting a sphere and trying to make a gradation that makes that look round, that's a full commitment to a three-dimensional illusion. If you're sort of trying to go around to fields of color, that starts to sort of put the mind in a more two-dimensional mode, and I suppose you could really brute force a three-dimensionality there, but it disengages from that in my experience. So if you're doing that, I'm not saying it's bad, and I'm not saying it couldn't work or create a certain style or aesthetic, but I would say that it decreases the likelihood of you being fully engaged with 3D formed or the idea of sculpting as you're painting. So if that's something you're struggling with and you're painting in that way, you might alter that. So I just say that now, it's a little bit off point, but I want to kind of cover the different ways one might paint, and that's a very common one. Here with these three spheres, I'm going to talk about the three main ways that people tend to paint form, this idea of making a three-dimensional sort of sculptural gradation. And there are basically three different ways one might go about doing it. I'm going to end with the one that I do and that I'm talking about in this video. And I'm going to start with one that I think is interesting and viable, but it does have some of the shortcomings I want to address. Okay, so without further ado, my God, that was a long preamble. This sphere right here, I'm going to illustrate one of the ways one might go about painting form. And this would be where you mix up the average midtone, the average tone that you see sort of in the center of the sphere here, not the brightest part, not the darkest part, the average midtone, and you sort of fill that in. Now, if it's not already clear, each of these spheres here that I'm imagining are under a light effect that's coming from our upper right. So you see the shadow edge here, right? So the back side of the sphere is in shadow, and the direction of the light is from our upper right on each one of these. So that's this sort of conceptual framework, the three-dimensional space and conditions I'm entering in. My God, I don't have a paper towel. I'm gonna have to get up from my chair. So I'm gonna imagine just a generic flesh tone here, and we'll mix up cat orange, titanium white, a touch of yellow ochre, a little alizarin crimson, raw umber. The last one's ivory black, if you're wondering. And I'm gonna make a sort of mid-tone, average mid-tone for this area, and we're gonna mix that in right here. Now this is by far the most efficient way to paint. And I don't dislike it. The shadow would eventually be darker. So you have this, and then in this, wet into wet, you start to bend the form, so to speak. So as you get near the shadow, you would gradate this down, and then near the lights, you would get lighter and more chromatic. This is imagined without a highlight. Obviously the most efficient way of painting form, but the downsides are you have to be pretty good at handling paint and moderating the amount of paint you're putting down so that you can continue to work back into that surface. The probably most common outcome, if you don't have that experience, is that you put down too much paint, you can't work back into it, it's still generic, you haven't finessed it. Anything new you put down in there, like a little bit of a hue shift towards red or yellow or neutral, gets lost, just gets soaked into the wet paint, and so you have to take even more and just shovel it in there, and then you end up with this very thick passage of paint, which again, that might be fine for aesthetic reasons, but if it's happening out of a lack of control, that texture that's building up is probably not the most aesthetically appealing, right? When you see rich texture and masterworks, you know, usually those are juicy brush strokes that sort of follow the form, describe the form, or a material quality on the form. And if it's happening more as a byproduct of you just trying to dump a lot of paint down to make a color change, it probably isn't going to look very good. You're going to end up with these ridges, and it makes it harder to paint back in. So I'm not saying this is bad. In fact, it is very efficient. It leads to a more generic outcome, and it requires a little bit of adeptness with paint handling. And so I kind of considered a little bit, even though it's faster, I considered a little bit more difficult to get a good outcome, because it's really the outcome. It's not the ease, it's the outcome, right? So it's deceiving because it seems the easiest. Now, the most common way that you'll see people model form in an atelier setting, in a form-oriented atelier, I would say the vast majority of people start modeling their form from the shadow edge up, meaning they would start right here along the shadow edge, and they would model to the summit of the form. Like right there is the lightmost facing point. They would start here and model up this way, all right? And you can sort of see this gesture I made here. I'm gonna paint this in a moment, showing this more clearly, but you can see how my brush is sort of traversing an imagined arc up to that point. And there is something about working from the shadow edge that kind of really creates that sense of that arc, or the sort of mesh, the three-dimensional mesh of that form. It could be any form on the face. Spheres are easy to conceptualize, so they're great for illustrating these ideas, but sort of imagining that sort of wireframe up from the shadow edge really creates in the mind a sense of three-dimensionality. And I would say that a lot of people that I've worked with or talked to about these ideas think or feel like they connect more with the form. They get more of that three-dimensional sense, the sense of that illusion, working from the shadow edge up. And I'm gonna come back to the importance of that, because that is important, right? And it sort of negates or sort of puts aside some of the arguments I'll make here in a moment about how I work, because I think feeling that form is just so important, having that sense of making something three-dimensional, believing in the illusion of that three-dimensionality while you work, I think is probably the most significant factor in terms of the ultimate outcome and the growth of your own skill. So that is an important thing to listen to. So let me illustrate that, and I'll come back to that point. So this would basically be, you start down here, and I'm gonna do a very, very fast version of this. Usually you would plod along and put down many little tiles of paint. I'm gonna sort of scrub my way through here for the sake of not making a 75 million hour video. So you get a little bit lighter. And part of the appeal here is that you get this arc like this going up to the summit of the form, and we worked out of the shadow edge to the lightmost facing point. Now, I'm going to show you how I tend to work, and when I do this, it's really just at the start of each new form. A form could be the ball of the nose, the bridge of the nose, the side plane of the nose, the nostril wing, the upper orbicularis oris, around to the bottom orbicularis oris, parts of the upper lip, the lower lip, the upper cheek.
right? So I break down the face or whatever I'm painting into sort of individual forms. I integrate them together, of course, that's a part of the process, but my entryway into each one is a individual form with a light orientation. And when I begin those, I start at the light most facing point. And I'll show you that right here. So I would start here, I have my white cat orange for this totally generic tone here. I wouldn't even necessarily call this a flesh tone, it's just a tone. And I would start right there. And then I would start to turn around like this. And if you've seen any of my videos where I'm painting portraits, you know, one of the common areas I start is that brow. I'll start above that eyebrow where the light is striking most directly, because I'll think about that as one whole form. And I'll start there, and then I'll go around that brow into the crease with the eyelid, and I create this sort of sphere-like little nugget. And I'm starting very often from the light most facing point. And I might do that on an eyelid next, which is sort of a slice of a sphere. I start at the light most facing point, and I work my way around to the darker tones. Then I would continue to work. And as you continue to work, you might move in every which way, right? So I might go around there, and I might do it again, and then I might work my way back up, and then I have a lot of paint down, and I start to push and pull. So it might begin like this. During the course of painting, I might go back up the other way, and then once I have it all in, I have a lot of paint down, and I start to push and pull. So you end up doing all of these. So it's not about sort of strictly adhering to one, it's about getting the best start. Now I want to come back to this idea of feeling form. For me, for the way I work and what interests me and the look I want in my paintings, the idea of form and feeling the form is what's most important. And if the notion, feeling the form, sounds kind of mystical or silly, it's really not. Just think of modeling a sphere from imagination and the effort you would put into making it look round and three-dimensional, the gradation you would have to make. Or think of something even simpler, like drawing a cube from imagination. And I don't mean the kind of cube where you draw a square, another square overlapping and connect the lines. I mean when you would just draw a plane, another plane, another plane. For better or for worse, you might be good or bad at doing that, but the activity, the sort of mind frame to kind of just place a cube three-dimensionally in space or to draw that sphere from imagination. Whatever that is, however that feels to you when you try to do those simple 3D volumes on paper, that's you believing in the illusion. So if you take that mindset or if you experience that mindset while you're painting a face, a cheek, an eye, doesn't mean it's going to go well, doesn't mean you're going to get the colors right, doesn't mean that you'll control the paint right off the bat. So it takes time, obviously. So, you know, frustration's normal, I guess is what I'm saying. But that mind frame is kind of what you're after. And for me, I know how difficult that is, especially if you're working with a model and they have a million different color shifts and it's complex and there's anatomy and there's 800,000 things to distract you. It's really hard to sustain that sensibility. So for me, whatever you have to do to kind of remind yourself that you should be feeling the form, that simplicity of believing in that illusion like you would if you're doing that sphere or cube, to muster that and sustain that over the course of painting something very complex, that's kind of where it is. And so whichever thing you choose, try to choose the one that gives you that strongest connection. My personal connection to the form is strongest when I work off that light most facing point, and you may very well be the same. And part of that, well, there are a few reasons, I suppose. Number one, I always try to lock into the light source in my scene, right? So if I'm kind of priming my mind or getting in that mode where I believe in this as three-dimensional, I immediately calibrate and lock into the light source, right? So in this scenario, right, we pass through here, through the canvas, and there's a sphere sitting here. And if we look up, just look up, you can see the light. The light's to our upper right, and it's coming down and hitting here. And there's, if you imagine like a pole, like a line from the light source to that light most facing point, that line, that imagined line between those two things is so important to me. I'm just latched onto it. Every video you see me post, everything I'm painting, regardless of whether or not you like the work and if I do this well, I can tell you fully
honestly, that I am locked into that light source and that orientation each and every time, for better or for worse. So I go in here, I go to that light, that's where I start, and I work off the light, and I touch down here, and then I begin modeling. For me, that gets me on the form fastest, and it has the benefit of really being locked onto that light source. Now, think about doing that, what I just described. I go into this space, right? Think of everything I described. I pass through the picture plane, I look for that light source, I go up to that light source, I imagine it, I follow it back down to the lightmost facing point, but I don't paint. I don't paint. Instead, now I imagine my way around this arc, I'm at that shadow edge, and now I work my way back up. It's just another step, and there's something in that last little bit there that takes me away from the light source. It's like I was already there where it was connecting to the form. Now I'm going to travel all the way around just to try to crawl my way back up. I know a lot of people that feel more connected to the form that way, and they like to walk uphill around that form. Me, I like to walk downhill. It's easier. Now let's talk about the benefits as I see them to working in this way and working off that lightmost facing point. The big thing is color. Let's say the two of us were to walk into a room and the lights were off, but there was a little dimmer switch on the wall. And I asked you, hey, what color are these walls in here? And you went over to the dimmer and you turned it on just a smidge, just like a little tiny bit. And the light came on and it was very dark in there. And you were like, I think the wall's green. And I look at you and I'm like, Mike, just turn the lights on. I can't even see this. So you turn them all the way on. And in fact, the wall is actually blue because it's very hard to see it. The more dim something is, the more neutral something is, the harder it is to ascertain the exact hue pitch. And so the same could be said for that area just before the shadow. Very often, people will start in that sort of shadowy or near shadowy area, the real drop off of light there before the shadow. They'll mix a color and then they'll try to climb uphill to the summit, hoping that their mixtures will get there in terms of the chroma and the exact hue pitch. And that can work, right? So if you are more attached to the form here, and that's very important, as I said, that's first, then you just have to do other things to make sure you hit that color. Maybe you mix a little key, like a little note that you put down there as a target. Maybe you just remain very, very conscious of it so that the mixtures that emerge on your palette really have a goal in mind. But you need to do something, because I think it's much more difficult to get that hue and that chroma pitch correct by the time you get to the summit compared to getting it correct or as correct as you can at the start and then dropping it off, lowering the chroma and lowering the value. So that is one of the main things. And I'll show you right here, a few things happen. So let's say I'm going to do basically the same idea on this bigger sphere here. And let's say I look at the form I'm painting and I say, you know, hue-wise, it's an orange. Let's say it's a yellow orange, just to have a little bit of variety here. So I grab a little bit of yellow ochre to mix in with that cadmium orange. And let's say it's going to be relatively light in value because it's where the light is striking most. And I mix that up and look what I have here. I have a nice big, and I'll make it even bigger, I have a nice big pool of paint that represents my best guess in this moment of what that color is on this particular form. Now, this is talking more about the palette, and what happens is now I have this where I can start to make any number of shifts into this, and I can lower the chroma and darken the value to start to make that form turn right here. And I try to retain some amount of that initial base color so I can return to it. And so I almost get this little tendril here mixed out of that. And the idea here is that on the palette, it's easier to go in this direction, mixing wise, than it is to go in this direction right here, right? So easier to darken the value and lower the chroma than it is to lighten the value and raise the chroma. So I clean the palette so we can imagine this from scratch, right? So let's imagine I started in the shadow area or near the shadow, and I'm mixing out my raw umber here. Things get really dim. I can't really see the chroma very well. And I put down a color. This represents right here, right? So let's imagine this is right here. And now I need to paint upwards around this here. I'm just going to do this in a strip to kind of really abstract the color changes here that I'm doing.
now on the palette, I need to start to get lighter in value. So I start to add my white to get lighter in value. Obviously, that's far too neutral. Now, here's one of the issues. A lot of classical realists are also trying to use a limited palette. And this is fairly limited right here. I don't have a lot of colors. Sometimes I add more. But the limited palettes I see don't have high chroma colors. They don't have high chroma options, meaning there's no cad orange, or there's not even an alizarin, right? There are a lot of substitutes here that narrow the range and the chroma potential on the palette. That kind of limited palette would probably stand a better chance working the way you see me work right here, because you start with the highest chroma potential and then you mix down your chroma, you mix down your value that from there. But if you're trying to work from the darker tones up to the summit and infuse chroma with a limited palette, again, imagine these two colors aren't here. That is incredibly difficult to do. Even if we just take the alizarin and the yellow ochre here and try to do this, getting that chroma up as we add more white gets harder and harder to do. And this results in one of the qualities that I see often and I have people describe to me as a problem they're struggling with, which is, and this is sort of a catch-all term, the reasons could be different in different scenarios, but people come to me and they say, my color looks so dead or washed out, right? Which I think is essentially a feature of it being too neutral or achromatic in the lightmost facing points, or the large sort of lightmost facing area of a particular form. And that's very often because they have this uphill battle where they're trying to get lighter by adding titanium white or lead white, doesn't matter. They're adding white, which is obviously extremely neutral, and they're doing that to raise the value, but they don't have potent enough colors. They don't have their cadmiums, they don't have high chromas to get that chroma up. Even with the cadmium, you know, you have to sort of brute force that chroma in there. But I would say if you are more inclined to work in this way, from the shadow to the lights, you 1000% want to have some kind of cadmium. And I like cadmium orange because regardless of the flesh tone, if it's a dark flesh tone, a light flesh tone, somewhere in the middle, if it's a little bit more yellow and it's local, a little bit more red, they're all sort of in that orange slice, which is why I like to say orange and not red, yellow, or yellow, red. So cad orange, I think, as a pigment on the palette, makes this far more successful, so we can get up to that higher chroma. So if you do feel more connected to the form working in this other way, from the shadows to the lights, just put a high chroma color or a cadmium orange on your palette, and I think you're going to have a better time with it and more success overall. And you have to remember that just the natural tendency over time as you mix, blend, and correct in your painting is for chroma to go down. As the different pigments mix together or you layer wet paint into wet paint, that tendency is for chroma to neutralize. So you have to be mindful to reinfuse chroma back into your painting. You have to do it on the palette and maybe revive that base color mixture as you start to create a mess here, which is inevitable. And the same is true on the painting. So always be thinking, hey, I've got to reintroduce chroma into this mixture. When I work with someone who is struggling with muddy color or washed out dead color, the first thing I have them do is start in the lights and start with that chromatic mixture, the chroma that it ought to be in relationship to what they're observing, starting there to get firm footing and to have a big pool of that on the palette that you then mix out of and then continually try to restore that. And that very often begins to correct that problem that that person is having. So if that's you, try this. Try reversing it. Try mixing that higher chroma to get firm footing from the start. Even err on the side of a little bit too chromatic, because the natural tendency is for that chroma to go down. And before you know it, you're drawing from contaminated pools on your palette. So you've got to make a conscious effort to restore that. And that might potentially lead to cleaner, more sort of deliberate and intentional color on the forms that you're modeling. Now, another little quick tip for some of you who are struggling with color mixtures. The way you start to mix your colors together on the palette can influence the outcome. So let's say you wanted to mix the same color that I've been going for here, this really sort of fluorescent orange. That's not exactly a flesh tone, I know. But if you're going to go for that particular color, let's say you started your mixture like this. You knew that raw umber was going to go into it. I already have a lot of paint on the brush. Raw umber, white, and then you add your orange, right? Now, I'm kind of exaggerating the effect here, but this is essentially what can happen.
For people that struggle with this and they end up with dead neutral color, I often suggest them to change the order in which they're mixing the colors. So let's say you know or you think that you ought to mix these three colors. Start with the high chroma color, the orange, and then mix the white and the raw umber into it. How you start it can influence the outcome. And I'll make the reverse suggestion for people who are dealing with colors that are too fluorescent, too chromatic, because that obviously can happen as well. I'll say, start your mixture with the white. Then add the orange into it and the raw umber. Just by changing the order within which you mix can sometimes offset that problem. Now, there are a few exceptions here that we need to talk about. We don't need to talk about them. I want to talk about them. You don't need to listen to them. You can turn this off. Please don't. But some of those exceptions would be, let's say, highlight. Now, that really depends. It introduces a big topic. I have another YouTube video. I'll try to remember to put the link in the description down below. But I have another YouTube video on highlights that talk about the geometry of highlights. And that's sort of a important background to what I'm going to describe here. Highlights occur at the angle of incidence equals the angle of reflection, not the light most facing point, unless you are looking at the form in the same location as the light source, like with flash photography or painting with a miner's helmet on or something like that. But in most scenarios, and certainly this scenario, we have the light over here, we're looking in here, the highlight is going to be at the angle of incidence equals angle of reflection. So what that means here, let's do this very quickly. This is not a highlight video. Light coming in most directly right here, us looking most directly at the sphere right here. Halfway between those two things would be the highlight there. That would be if it was a really shiny lacquered ball. And if it was a more matte or diffuse surface, we would have this highlight be a little bit softer like this, okay? So, fair enough, right? If we're just painting this sphere, I can sort of be like, all right, light most facing point is up here. I can see it clearly past the highlight. I can key that chroma, so on and so forth. However, let's imagine as we encounter on the face where this nostril wing is sphere-like, but attaches to the ball of the nose, and we have this ball of the nose attached to the bridge of the nose. We have all these different forms that are truncated or cut off by the form they join to. Like this is not a perfect sphere because we have my tear bag. My little tear bag overlapping that, we have the bottom of it feed into the masseter, so on and so forth. All of these forms are incomplete full spheres. They might be sphere-like, but they meet other forms that cut them off. Well, imagine that this sphere right here has another form right here that cuts off and it attaches right here. Like this is the chin. I know this is weird now, but this is the chin and this is the form just above the chin that attaches it. It right there. So just imagine this is another fleshy form. This looks horrifying. I know, bear with me. My God, I'm sorry. I hate having bad things down. It's like grating on the soul. Okay, so this is a new form that kind of cuts into here. Now, why this matters and why I'm going to proceed with this horrible mess of hamburger meat on my canvas is because the light most facing part of this form right now, the light most facing part, happens to be where the highlight is, right here, before it goes into the next form. Meaning we don't see what would be the light, actual light most facing point of a sphere because there's a different form adjoining here. And that's significant because very often we'll have forms where the light most facing area has this sheen or this highlight here, which makes the chroma significantly lower. And that kind of goes against this ideal that I'm talking here, where it's like, oh, let's mix this just pure, beautiful, high chroma color, and then we'll just go down from there. And you listen to that, you watch this video, and then you go and paint something, and you're like, my God, it's all neutral right there. Well, try to figure out if that's because of the highlight or a local color change. Very often the highlight, a sheen like this, you can move around, and you can see if it's actually a highlight. It would move with you if you're working from a photograph. You could still move around, but nothing's going to happen. But if it's very neutral and if it looks like a highlight, it's probably a highlight. In which case, maybe you start just to the side of that highlight over here. Maybe you still start from that area, but you know it's a highlight, so you factor that in. Other things that can obviously happen is that you can have
the local color change. Like if you're going around a cheek, the cheek could get more red down here, right? So it starts out more center orange, but it happens to get more red down here. And it's not going to necessarily change the routine. I still feel like I have the best chance starting at that lightmost facing point, keying that color, and then being open-minded. I still feel like it would be more difficult for me to work down here where I see the color least, have that uphill battle to the summit of the form, shift to red and shift to orange. It's still challenging, but I feel like I personally have more success factoring that in, working off the lightmost facing point. So just a question you have to ask yourself, and you know, the outcome is what matters. So you see what consistently works better for you. Another issue would be translucency, right? So if the form is semi-translucent, like flesh is, and that sort of is more powerful as an effect depending on where you are on the face, like the nostril, right? This little ridge of the lips here, the ears, you'll have a lot of light transmitting through that form just before the shadow edge. And as that light goes through, it is more selectively absorbed through the surface below, or blood vessels and the like, you're going to have not only a increase in chroma, you're going to have a hue shift, very likely more towards red, and so that'll factor in here. But even though that's high chroma down there, I would say that that is even more of a reason to start on the lightmost facing point, because if you're painting near the shadow and you're dealing with translucency, or let's say a really powerful reflected light source that overlaps the shadow into the darkest lights, that's going to be a smaller effect and it's going to drop off faster than the main light effect. So to start there where you're having this sort of overlap of reflected light, transmitting light for the translucency, and it's creating these hue shifts and these chroma shifts as the light passes through that surface, and then all of a sudden you get like 10, 15, 20 degrees up and you have to drop that off back to a more neutral before you get high chroma again, that gets very complicated. I would say the best course of action is work off the lightmost facing point, drop down around the form, and as soon as that sort of three-dimensionality coalesces, painting translucent effects or even reflected light effects that overlap the terminator, that's not all that common, but it does happen. Painting that back in wet into wet is actually easier to do, and that is partly due to the alizarin crimson having an incredible tinting strength at a darker value. A little bit of alizarin crimson and cat orange and those darker tones after you've achieved the form really gives you that sort of translucency, subsurface scattering in certain geometric areas, and reflected light. Very powerful pigments for that particular effect. And just think about that if you ever watch my videos and you watch me paint a full thing where maybe I don't describe everything I'm doing. When I get into those areas where I really bring out the chroma, this is what's operating in the back of my mind, or in the front of my mind, the middle of my mind, the sides of my mind. What? All right, so that looks amazingly bad, but I hope the ideas were good, and I hope that you can see some of these things in my actual paintings and some of my other tutorials. And the biggest hope I have is that maybe some of these ideas help improve your color, help improve your form, and kind of reinforce habits during the painting process. Because most often painting feels like you're treading water, so if you can have a nice, good, clear, intentional start, things tend to go better. And you can always sort of correct back to that point. If things get messy, clean your palette off and kind of recalibrate on that new form and just try to kind of get into that habit. And I think better things will happen. Thank you so much for checking out this video. If you like my content, you want to see more, and you want to support this channel, check me out at patreon.com/ScottWaddell. Countless tutorials. It's $12 a month, and it really helps me make more YouTube videos. You can cancel anytime, but in that time that you decide to support this channel, you'll have tons of content, art and structural content, where you see paintings in real time, portraits, still life, all sorts of things. So check out patreon.com/ScottWaddell. Or if you don't like subscriptions, you can go to my website. That's scottwaddellfineart.com. There I have countless tutorials that you purchase, you download, they're yours to keep. And if you're so inclined, you can check out my online classes and study with me one-on-one, and that's at scottwaddellfineart.com. And if nothing else, make sure you hit that like button or subscribe button if you want. And you don't have to. You don't have to make sure. Do what you want. But I'd like it. It'd make me feel good. Okay, I'll leave it there. Bye.